So you're stuck in a dungeon with a 20-sided die, and a dragon is keeping you in the dungeon, and the dragon will only let you out if you can roll a particular total on the dice. Now you get to choose what the total is, so please could you choose me a number that's bigger than 20?
All right, how about 42?
42, good number. Okay, so then your challenge is to roll the die and try to get 42. If you hit 42, you win, you get to leave the dungeon. If you don't hit 42, then you get kept in the dungeon with the dragon forever. So let's give it a go.
I get one go.
You get one go.
All right, let's see how we do. All right, here we go. First roll.
That's five.
Five. Okay.
That's a good start. You haven't gone past 42 yet.
Okay.
Oh, 16.
16.
That's also pretty good. 21, we're halfway.
Another 5 and 16 would be good.
Be good, wouldn't it? 12. So now what do you want to win here?
What are we on? We're on 21, 33.
So I think you need another 9 to be home.
9 more, okay.
Of course, smaller than 9 would be okay.
Yeah, all right.
Oh.
6.
6, so we're still playing.
All right.
3 to go.
Come on, we want a 3. Lucky 3. Come on.
Ah! Oh,
11. I busted past it.
Yeah, past 42. It's a bit like that game where you have to get to 21 without going over 42. So unfortunately, the dragon sees that you've gone past 42 and it's game over. But I think 42 was quite a good pick because you had lots of outs along the way. You didn't go out too quickly and there were lots of possibilities along the way. I think the natural question is, what's the best number that you could have picked? More than 20, but what's the best number? The one that's most likely to come up when you roll the die. It's not even obvious that there is such a number, I suppose. Maybe they're all equally good. Maybe it doesn't matter, so you should just pick 42. What do you think about that?
I think if such a number exists, it has to be 40 or less.
40 or less. Okay, so you want it so that you could get it in two rolls.
Yeah. But and it feels like the highest it could be is double the number. Otherwise, it feels like it just becomes arbitrary after you get to double the highest number.
Yes, that's the right intuition. That to start off with, the effects of sort of finite size of the die matter really quite a lot. And then in the long run, things even out. We can even be a bit precise about how things even out. So eventually, you're getting large numbers. Maybe you picked a target number that was 1,000,000,003 or something. So after a while, you're rolling and rolling, and I guess you're still alive because you haven't got to 1,000,000,003 yet. The die has an average. It has an average number that it rolls on average, which over the long run, as you're trying to get to 1,000,000,000, that's kind of what your experience is going to be. The die has an average, which means that you hit every number every so often. The probability that any particular number comes up is one in the average length of skips that you take when you roll. The average of a 20-sided die is 10.5, I think. So for a very large number, like 1,000,000,000 or something, your odds of seeing that particular number, 1,000,000,003, is about one in 10.5, which is that weird mix of being an approximation while also a weirdly precise number, which is not great odds. Question, can you do better than that by picking a small number? And the answer is, yes, you can. So the odds that you see 100, I'm going to write P for probability and 100 for the probability that you see the number 100. That's like you chose a three-digit number, P100, for the target. Well, in order to see 100, we have to think about what the previous number was. And maybe you saw 99 and then you rolled a 1. Or maybe you saw 98 and then you rolled a 2. Or maybe you saw 97 and then you rolled a 3, and so on and so on and so on. Or maybe you saw 80 and you rolled 20. So this is something you can do to relate this back to the previous numbers. This is an example of something called a recurrence relation, where I don't know the number that I'm looking for straight away, but I can work it out in terms of smaller problems to break down the problem into these smaller parts. There's a bit of work to do here if I want P100. So I'm going to have to keep working backwards through all these previous numbers. For numbers less than 20, there's also a chance that you just roll it straight away, that there wasn't any previous roll at all. You just got straight in there and rolled it.
But you didn't allow that in the game.
I think it's a more fun game if you have to pick a number more than 20. None of this cheeky roll it straight away on the die. That's why I made you pick a number bigger than 20. Armed with that recursion relation, you can get a computer to work out the probabilities that different numbers come up. And the graph is kind of interesting. So the graph looks like this. The probability that you see sum total of 1 is, well, something, because you might roll it straight away. The probability that you see 2 is a little bit larger, because you might roll it straight away, or you might roll 1 twice to get your 2. And then, in a similar manner, the probabilities get larger and larger, up to 20, which is the last number which benefits from this effect that you could just roll it straight away. 21 isn't so fortunate. 21, you have to make it in 2 rolls. And it's actually quite likely that you blow past 21 on this 20-sided die. The probability that you hit 21 is down here somewhere.
Oh, really low.
It's a lot lower, somewhere in between the probabilities for 1 and 20 on the graph. But then things get a little bit better for a brief window. The next bit of the graph looks like this, with a sort of arch shape. And at 40, there's a kink in the graph, and then it levels off. And at 60, it smooths out even more, and there's another wobble in the graph, and it flattens out towards this kind of long-term probability of 1 in 10 and a half. But the absolute best point is, like you said, Brady, between 20 and 40, there's some maximum on this graph. It turns out that the number 34 is the best total that you could give to the dragon. And I just know that because I've done the calculations and checked the probabilities that different numbers come up. If you want to check it, you could roll the die quite a lot and see which different totals come up. I claim the number 34 comes up more than any other number bigger than 20.
Did I hit 34? 21, 33.
33 is pretty close. So around 34, these numbers are all pretty likely to come up.
Yeah.
So a number around 33 to 35. If I let you pick a couple of numbers that are near each other, some sort of little interval maybe, here's the target I'm aiming for, plus or minus 2, then centering it on 34 is still a good idea, but it gets much more likely if I give you a little interval that you could hit.
If you'd allowed any number though, 20 is the one to pick.
Yes, any number at all, 20 is the most likely one to come up on sums. Just between 1 and 20, things get more and more likely as you have more and more ways to make those numbers, plus also the bonus of maybe rolling them in 1 and just getting it straight away on that die. So I guess the kind of next question after 20 is really likely to come up, 34 is the next most likely. So it's a bit of a random number, 34, somewhere between 20 and 40. I suppose the extension to this question is, what happens if I get stuck in a different dungeon with a larger dragon who owns a larger die with more sides on it, so it goes to a bigger number?
Well, the question I've got before you answer that question is, what if the dragon has the most common die that most people have?
Oh, sure.
A six-sided die.
Yeah, six-sided die. There's a very similar picture, maximum between 6 and 12, that you should pick as a number that's going to come up in your running total when you roll that six-sided die in the dungeon of the dragon.
But you want a bigger die, bigger than 20.
Yeah, so there's this kind of smooth pattern that we get with these dots on the graph, which gets smoother and smoother the more dots that you have. To get more dots, I need more faces on the die. And the calculations get harder. So just in case you're trapped in a dungeon with a very large die, it'd be good to have a rule of thumb or some sort of heuristic about where this is in terms of, I don't know if this is
that sweet spot.
That sweet spot is somewhere between n and 2n. This sweet spot for where this kind of curve of the graph hits its maximum, the best probability that you can pick. The heuristic, or the answer in general to leading order, is that that peak happens at e minus 1 times n, where e is the number 2.7, I guess it comes up in problems like this.
Quite a natural log or whatever they
are. Yeah, the base of natural logarithms, but then subtract 1 and multiply by n. So this is a rule of thumb for where that maximum lies for very large n, which does give you about 34 for for the dragon in our original problem. Maybe weird that that's not a whole number. E is irrational, so this is never a whole number, no matter how big the die is. But this gives you a good approximation to where the maximum of the function is. There's some really nice continuous version of this problem where you have a die that sort of could roll any number, and it gives us this proper smooth distribution. The one that's kind of hiding in between the dots. It's the sort of correct way to join the dots and have this kind of version of the problem where the dragon wants you to hit some interval between some number and some other number. So there's an application of this to evil numbers. An evil number is one where the decimal expansion of that number, so if you take your favourite number like pi or something, 3.14159265, and you keep going, and if you add up the digits, so 3 plus 1 plus 4 plus 1 plus 5 plus 9, and keep going, if at some point that equals the number 666, then you say that your number is evil. And bad news, pi is evil. The digits add up to 666
at some point. At some point.
You get 666, pi is evil. There's some very similar mathematics you can run to talk about the probabilities that you hit any particular target. 666 is quite a large number, so we're in that realm of long-term probabilities. And because the digits could be 1 or 2 or 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, the average for what the digits could be, I guess I'm ignoring 0, but zeros don't really get you anywhere closer to your rolling total, they just delay the inevitable. The average that you get when you actually make progress on your total is this, which is the number 5, I think, because that tops 45. Because the average is 5, that means that along the way, once the numbers are large, your running total hits roughly every one number in 5. It's taking jumps of about 5 each time, so it hits roughly every fifth number. Not exactly, of course, it's random, but it hits roughly every fifth number. Which means that, unfortunately, 20% of numbers are evil. 1 in 5, 20% of them are evil, including things like the square root of 3 or the golden ratio turn out to be evil numbers as well.
Hmm. Not E, though.
I don't know. I don't know if E is evil. We could try and work it out, but we'd need quite a lot of digits of E. This keeps you busy on a rainy day. You need a lot of decimal digits, I suppose about 100 of them, in order to add them up and then check, did you hit exactly 666 or not on your way up? So it's just like the die rolling problem, if you like, but with a nine-sided die. I don't know how to make a nine-sided die, but perhaps that's what the digits are doing.
I like that. I like that pi is evil.
We've had a different definition of evil numbers on Numberphile before to do with prime numbers, but this is another evil number definition. I've seen a third one as well, so there's another way that people refer to evil numbers to do with their binary expansion as well, but I think that's one for a different Numberphile video to do.
You chose 666 because of the biblical, famous biblical reference. I guess you could come up with any cool number. Like 42.
42 is a good
number. And you could call that a hitchhiker number.
That would be nice.
Is pi a hitchhiker number? Does it hit 42? And things like that.
Let's do the graph for adding up numbers up to 9, because 42 is somewhere in between multiples of 9, so maybe it's near a maximum of one of those. Maybe it's more likely to come up than 666 in our digits. Let's do the graph, I suppose. Calculate some probabilities. Footnote, I maybe didn't mean to have the 3 plus at the start. Maybe evil numbers just use the decimal digits, I can't remember. In my defense, all of this is made up anyway. None of this really matters.
It's not really evil.
It's not really evil either way.
You can't call pi evil. Pi, everyone loves pi.
The fractional part of pi is definitely evil.
Okay.
Maybe the 3 saves it.
Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this video. Now, you probably know all about Brilliant by now, makers of these fantastic courses and quizzes covering math, logic, data science, neural networks, computer programming, all sorts of stuff. I've shown you examples like this before, but I don't think I've ever mentioned how great they are on your phone or handheld devices. The seamless design, all the interactive material, it's an absolute delight. Smooth, great to look at. So you can be building your skills and knowledge on a train or on the bus to work, just sitting around on the sofa. Now look, I'll be honest, I can't be absolutely sure all the people in this footage are doing brilliant courses, but I like to think that guy is, and they definitely all should be on Brilliant. There's so much great stuff on there, they're always adding more material as well. This could be the start of your path to a new career, or maybe just a way to sharpen your mind. Go to brilliant.org/numberphile to start a free 30-day trial, and you'll get 20% off an annual plan. Check out the link in the video description. Yeah, they must be looking at Brilliant.
It's lots of things. It's a beastly prime, okay? So a beastly prime is one that has 666 in it. Now, this one has it in a very special place right in the middle, right? But a beastly prime is one that has 666. So, for example, another beastly prime is this one. 6661. 26669 is a beastly prime. There's a whole bunch of these as well.